And in this section, we're going to talk about the topic of ions and ionic charge. So you might wonder why, since we've been talking about molecules in the last section and naming molecular compounds, why are we now switching gears to talking about something that sounds different, which is ions? That's because, remember back when we talked about the two broad classes of chemical items we'll basically discuss in this class as far as chemical reactions. We had the molecular compounds, which is sort of one branch, which is basically a two non-metals whenever they're combined. And then we have the other branch, which is called the ionic compounds, when we have a metal from the left-hand side of the periodic table plus a non-metal from the right-hand side of the periodic table. And we talked about the characteristics of both of those, and we'll get into that later. Well, before we can really discuss ionic compounds and how they form, it's really important to understand what an ion is, right? Because how are you going to understand what an ionic compound is if you don't even know what an ion is? So what we're going to do in this section is basically review what an ion is, and also I'm going to tie that back to the periodic table, because it turns out for a whole lot of elements, you can figure out what the ion is going to look like just by looking at the periodic table and the way that it's set up. And that's going to help you over and over and over and over again in chemistry when you start forming these ionic compounds. So the first thing to remember, forget about ions for just a second. It's a fancy sounding name. It's a very easy concept. Remember back to the atom. We said that we had protons and neutrons in the nucleus, right? The atomic number of the element is equal to the number of protons that we have in the nucleus. And surrounding that guy, we have electrons that are orbiting around an electron cloud, and they're kind of orbiting like this. But we always said that every atom is electrically neutral on the whole. Even though it has positive protons in the nucleus and it has negative electrons surrounding the nucleus, because we have equal number of positive protons in the center and negative electrons going around, if there's equal number of positive negative, then if you zoom out on the atom, you don't really notice that there's positive negative. You just, those kind of things kind of cancel out, and you basically have a neutral atom. And that's everything. That's my shirt. That's this, you know, this plastic pen. That's the board. They all consist more or less of neutral atoms. So let's review that here, and then we'll talk about how we go from having a neutral atom to having what we call an ion. So if the word ion bothers you or scares you or worries you because it sounds foreign and different, don't worry about it, because it's very, very simple. So let's take as an example lithium, right? So you can look on the periodic table and find the symbol Li. So let's look at Li for lithium. And I'm just picking that just because it's a fairly simple atom. There's nothing special about lithium in particular. Lithium's atomic number is 3, right? So let me write that down. So the atomic number is equal to 3. So you can find that on the periodic table. I encourage you to do that, actually, if you haven't already done that. So what that means, because its atomic number is 3, is that it has 3 protons in the nucleus. So I'm going to write them like this. So these are plus charges. So this is like a proton here, and this is a proton here, and this is a proton here. Now there are also neutrons in this nucleus here. I'm not going to draw them here only because I'm trying to keep the drawing simple. But just remember, there are neutrons in the nucleus there. The number of neutrons is going to determine what isotope you're really talking about. We talked about isotopes before. But remember, neutrons don't have any charge, so they're not really going to participate in any of this charge discussions. So just remember, I'm drawing a simple nucleus here with the 3 protons reflecting the atomic number, but there are some electrically neutral neutrons in there as well. Okay, so surrounding this guy, we have electrons. How many electrons do you think we're going to have for a neutral atom of lithium? Well, we're going to have 3 of them. So this is 1 electron. Let's say another one we have over here, and let's say another one we have, let's say, over here. And these guys, we're going to say, for the sake of being simple, they're just basically orbiting. Now, I'll tell you right now, and I've said this before, the real picture of an atom is not really look like this. It doesn't really have 3 little balls of electrons, and they're not going nice around the nucleus like a solar system. It isn't really like that. When you get down and study quantum mechanics and figure out what an atom really sort of behaves and sort of manifests itself as. But this model is pretty darn good for visualizing what we need to visualize, which is really how electrons come and go in the atom. But just know that when you get deeper into chemistry, and if you go on and study physics and other things and really look at the atom, it doesn't really behave like a little solar system. But it's a pretty good model for what we're studying here. So we have three and three. So it's neutral, right? Because of that. So we have, for instance, you're going to have three of these guys plus three of these guys. So this is a neutral atom. So far we're kind of reviewing. We've done nothing really new. Now let's go and redraw this guy down here, right below it, let's say. And let's say we still have, obviously, the three protons in the center. I'll put pluses for those guys just to kind of keep the board clear. But let's say that I reach my magic hand in here and grab one of these electrons and pull it away. Just yank it out of the atom. So what I'm going to have left with is one electron here, and let's say one electron here. I have removed one of the electrons, I still have two left. So don't forget, there's still neutrons here in the nucleus, but I'm not drawing them. So I have the three protons here, and I have the two electrons here orbiting, and I've removed one of these electrons. And there are many ways to do this, by the way. There's many ways to strip an electron off of an atom. You can do it with electric field, which means electricity. You can do it, enlightening. Lightning is what you're really seeing, is when you start stripping electrons off of the air and in the atmosphere. You start seeing the flash of light that results from that. That's the lightning you see. The sun is basically doing that all the time to the surface of the sun there. The atoms that comprise the surface are basically just a soup of electrons that have been yanked off of the gases and things. So this stuff really does exist. It's just we don't really touch it usually with our hands. But if we take one away, what is going to be the result of this guy? In other words, what is the charge of this? Is it going to be neutral after we do this? It cannot be neutral because we have three positive guys and two negative guys. So this guy is going to have a net plus one charge. So in other words, if we take this neutral atom that we started with and we pull one electron away, the resulting guy is not neutral anymore. He has a net positive charge. So if you zoom out to this guy here and look at him, you're not going to necessarily see individually what's happening, but you'll know that if you took a measurement meter and measured this guy, he's going to have a net positive charge because it's no longer balanced. So we don't really refer to this as an atom anymore, even though it is an atom. We really refer to it as an ion. So this is an ion. It's a positive ion. Ion is just a word that means atom that has a charge on it now. That's basically what it means. So the word ion, scares people sometimes because it's a fancy sounding name, but basically think of any atom you can imagine. This paper, my skin, my hair, whatever. If I could reach in and pull some electrons away, then my atoms would have some kind of charge, net charge left over, right? And so we would call it an ion. Either it's a positive ion if it loses electrons like this, so it has a net positive charge. The same thing can happen if I took this atom, if I could magically stick another electron in here, if I could do that, then I would have an extra negative charge. So I would have a net negative charge. So we would call it a negative ion. So ions can be positive or negative, just depending on the atom that you have and if it has lost an electron or if it has gained an electron. So we have special names for this guy. I mean, this guy, not so special really, we would call it a lithium ion. But in general, and if you have a calcium, you could call it a calcium ion if it lost an electron. Or a chlorine atom, if a chlorine atom gained an extra electron, you would call it a chlorine ion, right? So not too hard here. But we have special names. If we have a positive ion or a negative ion, chemistry has special names for that, so we're going to learn those here really quickly. They have a name called a cation, just like kitty cat ion. And that's a positive ion, positive charged ion. And what can you guess this guy's going to be? Anion. It's a negative charged ion. So this is just a classic test question. You ask, something is referred to as an anion. What is the charge on it? Well, you know right away. If it's called an anion, it's got a negative charge. If it's called a cation, it's called a positive charge. These things are historical. You're not going to really use definitions like this when you're balancing chemical equations and all that good stuff, but it's a definition, and it's important in science to know what the definitions are so that when you're reading a book, you're not just glossing over it, you really understand what they're trying to say. But it's a very easy thing to think about. This guy, since it's lost an electron, it now has a net positive charge. It is a cation, right? If I had a chlorine atom that gained an electron or two, then it would have a negative charge and we would call it an anion. So that's very, very simple. I'm not going to dwell on it more anymore here because that's basically it. So if we wanted to give a few examples of how you would write these ions down, I mean, we can call it lithium ion, we can call it calcium ion, we can call it oxygen ion, we can call it hydrogen ion. You know, that's fine. But how do we write it down? If we have sodium, right? The chemical symbol for sodium on the periodic table was Na, right? If sodium loses an electron, one electron, see, this is a neutral guy when we write it just like this, neutral, no charge, because we have a balancing of positive and negative charges. If we lose an electron, it's going to have a net positive one charge. So we just put a plus up here. We don't have to put a plus one. We just call it plus. And this is if it loses, it lost one electron. So if sodium, which is balanced and neutral, loses one electron, we write the ion as Na plus. The plus designates that it's positively charged with one unit of charge because the one is kind of implied, right? All right, what if we have a chlorine atom, right? And what if the chlorine atom gains one electron? How do we write this ion down? So it's a chlorine ion or a chloride ion. You can think of sodium chloride. The guys on the right-hand side of the periodic table, when we name the ions, and also later on you'll see in the compounds, they get an IDE, so it's a chloride ion. So this is chlorine. If it gains an electron, what do you think we're going to put up here? Well, if it gains an electron, it's going to be negative, negative charge. So we put a negative here. And it's only gained one electron, so it's only gained one charge. So we don't have to put the one. The positive implies a one. The negative implies a one. And you don't have to write the number one. It's kind of like the subscripts for sodium chloride, NaCl. You don't write the ones. You just kind of write everything else. So that's Cl with a little negative sign up there in the upper right-hand side. What about magnesium, Mg? Okay, what are we going to call this guy? Or how are we going to write it if it lost... two electrons. If magnesium loses two electrons, well, if it loses two electrons, that means it was neutral. It lost two negative guys. So what's going to remain is more positive charge in the nucleus. So it's going to be positive ion. It's going to be a cation with a charge of plus two. So the way you write that is two plus in the upper right hand side. So this is how you would write this ion down. Right, Mg2 plus. So it means this stable atom that we had has a charge of positive 2 because we lost the two electrons. We'll just do a couple quick more to give you a little bit of practice. If you have aluminum, right, Al, and aluminum lost three electrons, how would you write it? Well, this was a neutral atom. If it loses three electrons, that means it's going to have a positive 3 charge net at the end. So you write it as 3 plus. Put the number first, put the sign after, so 3 plus. So this is an aluminum ion, a positive aluminum ion, which is a cation because it's positive. And the final one, let's say we have oxygen, and let's say oxygen gained 2 electrons, which by the way is what oxygen likes to do. It likes to gain electrons. So if it gains extra negative charge, then it's got to be negative. And its charge is going to be negative 2. So we put a 2 and we put the negative sign there in the upper right-hand corner. So O, 2, negative. So hopefully you can see how this basically works. It's very simple. However many electrons are lost or gained is going to be equal to the number that we write up here. Of course, if it's 1, we don't have to write the number. And the sign comes about as a result of you thinking about it, basically. If you gain negative electrons, your atom is going to turn into a negative ion, which is called an anion. If you lose electrons, what you're going to have left is more positive charge because the nucleus is going to dominate, so you'll have a cation, and the number is just going to be equal to how many electrons are gained or lost. So I've kind of hinted around by giving you these examples that these atoms can form ions by gaining or losing electrons, right? And that's universally true. So I hope you see there's nothing mystical about this. Basically, the universe consists of atoms. If you take an electron away from that atom, you're going to be left with a net positive ion. We call it a cation. If you give the guy electrons, then we're going to be left with a net negative ion, which we call an anion. And the way we write it is, the number represents the charge on this ion. The positive or negative represents whether it's positive or negative. Now, this is really, really important because when we start forming compounds with these ions, basically, we're going to have what we call an ionic compound. Knowing the charge and knowing what that means is going to be absolutely crucial to understanding that. So now what I want to do is turn our attention. We've talked about the atoms. We've talked about the fact that they can gain and lose electrons, become ions. What I want to talk about now is the fact that you can use the periodic table to, in some cases, or in a lot of cases, predict what ion is going to want to form for some of these guys. So in other words, I wrote these down and kind of gave them to you, but you know, if you didn't know this, if I erased the board, I could ask you, what is the charge on a sodium ion? And you would be able to tell me. I should be able to ask you, what is magnesium like to form? Is it positive or negative ion? And you should be able to tell me. I should be able to tell you, hey, oxygen, does it like to form a positive or a negative ion? And what charge does it like to form? And you would be able to tell me. And you would be able to get that info straight from the periodic table, because the periodic table, the way it is laid out, lets you figure that stuff out, which is crucial when we go to forming compounds with these materials, knowing what the charges are on the ions. So let's go ahead and do that. Let's look at a periodic table right now. So in front of your in your screen, you see our periodic table that I'm using here to teach you a few things. But really, you need to open your book, your textbook, to whatever periodic table you have in your book, because that is going to be what you're going to be using. So get familiar with your stuff. But I'm going to show you a few general things. So we've gone over the periodic table before, but I just want to go over a few more things here. So look on the left-hand side, the two columns or the two groups on the left-hand side, they're called group 1A and group 2A. And then we talked about the middle guy here, the B group elements. The B group are the shorter grouping of elements, the really massive grouping of elements in the center. That has a lot of your metals in there that you might think of, zinc and copper and things like that in the middle there. On the right-hand side, we have the crooked staircase line. To the left of that, we still call those metals. To the right of the staircase line, we call them generally non-metals. Now, right around that staircase, we did say that those are metalloids, which mean they kind of have characteristics of metals and non-metals. But for the most part, everything to the left of the staircase is basically a metal. Everything to the right of the staircase is basically a nonmetal. Now, this is very, very, very important, what I'm about to say here. So listen very, very carefully. In group 8, 8A over there on the right-hand side, everything in that very last group over there is what we call a noble gas. So look at those guys on your periodic table. Helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon. Those things in the right-hand column of the periodic table are noble gases. You might want to think of them as perfect gases, really, and you'll see why in just a second. Basically, those guys in group 8 over there, they are absolutely stable. They do not form ions because they do not like to give up their electrons and they do not like to gain extra electrons. You might say, why is that? Why is that special? Well, the reason that they line up in a group like this is because what I told you before when we talked about the periodic table, lots of properties are kind of shared in common among these groups. So group 8, they're all noble gases and they share that property of being quote unquote perfect. They don't like to react with things. They don't react with sulfur. They don't react with potassium. They don't react with anything. They're completely inert. The reason why they don't react is because their electrons that are in those orbits of those atoms are, without getting too complicated, basically they're perfectly stable. They're at an energy state where those electrons, they don't want to go anywhere. They are perfectly happy sitting where they are because they're in the most stable configuration. So when you have a noble gas, you can rest assured that it's not going to form an ion. It's not going to do anything. It's going to hang on to those electrons. And to give you a sneak preview, it's because the electrons are filling up in the different orbitals and everything is nice and stable and full when you get over into column 8 over there. So when you look at helium, when you look at neon, when you look at argon, those electrons are filled up in the different electron orbitals in such a way that everything's perfectly full and perfectly stable. So we're not going to try to lose any electrons or gain any electrons. Now, I keep harping on it because what I want you to view the periodic table, I want you to view column 8 as basically perfect. Every other atom on this periodic table, every other element, and listen carefully, every other element on this periodic table wants to be stable like column 8, like group 8. So, you know, you look over, look at column 7 here. That's the easiest way to explain it. Column 7 has elements in there like fluorine and chlorine and bromine and iodine, for instance. Okay? Those atoms, they're pretty darn close to column 8, but they're not quite there. So how do you think they're going to get there? When you have an element, a non-metal, that's right next on the right-hand side of the periodic table, let's look, for instance, at fluorine. Fluorine is a symbol F. It's one column away from column 8. So when it reacts, fluorine wants to gain one electron to try to move itself over to the right, to be just like column 8. That's what its tendency is to do. Because gaining one electron for fluorine makes it more perfect like a noble and stable gas. The noble gas is in column 8. Very important that you understand this. And chlorine, for instance, which is directly under fluorine, behaves exactly the same way. It's in column 7. It wants to gain one electron to go over to column B, to be like column 8, I guess I should say. In other words, gaining an electron in the context of a chemical reaction is the most stable thing for fluorine to want to do, right? So they all behave the same way in group 7 like that. Fluorine likes to gain one electron to move over to be like a noble gas. Chlorine likes to do the same thing. Bromine likes to gain one electron. Iodine likes to gain one electron to go over. So you can think of everything on the right-hand side, like column 6, it's one column away from column 8. And so you kind of have to do a little bit of learning here by just sort of example. So I'm telling you that everything in column 7 likes to gain one electron to move over to the to be like a noble gas, because noble gas is the perfect part of the periodic table. So let me ask you this. Look at column 6. Look at oxygen. If the guys in column 7 like to gain one electron to be like a noble gas, how many electrons do you think oxygen wants to gain in the context of a chemical reaction? Well, it's in column 6, and if you kind of use your finger on your table and kind of jump over from column 6 to column 8, you can see that there's two jumps it has to take. So electrons, or I should say oxygen, wants to gain two electrons to be like a noble gas. So that's what we always say. Oxygen, the most stable ion of oxygen is 2. Is negative 2, because it likes to gain 2 electrons to be like a noble gas. And all of the guys in column 6 behave the same way, more or less. So you have sulfur. Sulfur is in column 6. It likes to gain 2 electrons to be like a noble gas. What's another one here besides sulfur? Selenium. Selenium in general likes to gain 2 electrons to be like a noble gas. So the same general thing happens. If we go over and get out of column 6 and look at column 5, right? Look at nitrogen. How many electrons do you think nitrogen is going to want to gain? Well, you can just use your finger and hop over, and you can see it takes 3 electrons for nitrogen to be like a noble gas. So it's going to want to gain 3 electrons. Look at phosphorus. It's in the same column. It's going to want to gain 3 electrons. This is crucial information for you to know, because in the next section I'm going to ask you how to form these compounds, and knowing how these elements are going to form these ions is going to be the key to doing that. You just have to know how to do that. Okay, so that's, I think, enough on the right-hand side of the periodic table. These guys, these nonmetals that are on the right-hand side by the noble gases, they like to gain the number of electrons needed to be like a noble gas, which is perfect gas in column 8. Now let's turn our attention over to the left-hand side of the periodic table, groups 1 and group 2, the first two columns, first two groups on the very left side of the periodic table. Now, you might think that, let's take an example, you might think that lithium might want to gain a whole bunch of electrons to be like a noble gas, so it kind of scoots itself to the right. But it turns out that things behave a little differently, because now we are on the other side of the jagged staircase that's on your periodic table. So the metals on the left-hand side, they don't like to gain electrons. All of the metals like to lose electrons. Notice that we talked about that before. Ions can be created by gaining or losing electrons. So just take a guess. How many electrons do you think lithium, Li, has to lose in order to be like a noble gas, because that is its goal in forming a chemical reaction with something, right? Lithium is in group 1, so if you can kind of put your finger on lithium and lose an electron, you're going to wrap around the other way, going back the other direction to column 8. So if you lose one electron, you wrap around perfectly to group 8, which is the noble gases. So in other words, lithium likes to lose one electron, and losing one electron puts its electrons in a configuration that's very stable, like a noble gas. So again, it's trying to be like a noble gas, it's just it's doing it by losing one electron. Same thing for sodium, which is right under. Sodium is in the same group. It likes to lose one electron. So the stable isotope, I shouldn't say isotope, that's not true. The stable ion of lithium and sodium, both are just going to be plus one because they're going to lose one electron each. Same thing is true of potassium, rubidium, cesium, and so forth. Everything in that group wants to lose one electron so that it can be like a noble gas and wrap around to the other side of the table. Now, if that's the case, what do you think is going to happen with beryllium, which is in group 2? Well, beryllium, it wants to lose how many? 2 electrons, because by losing 2, it's going to, if you can kind of trace your finger left, it's going to hop over to column 1, and then it's going to wrap around to the other side of the table and land on the noble gases. So by losing 2 electrons, beryllium can be stable like a noble gas. Same story for magnesium. Magnesium loses 2 electrons, and it becomes stable like a noble gas. Calcium does the same thing. It loses 2 electrons. Strontium does the same thing. It loses 2 electrons. Everything in that column wants to lose 2 electrons to be like a noble gas. So you've got this information built into the periodic table. So in your chemical, in your equations and in reactions and your exams and your homework and stuff, nobody's going to tell you that sodium wants to be a plus one ion. Nobody's going to tell you it wants to lose an electron to be a positive ion. Nobody's going to tell you that calcium wants to lose 2 electrons to be a plus 2 ion. Nobody's going to tell you that oxygen wants to gain 2 electrons to be a negative ion. That is going to be information that you have to know by looking at the periodic table, just by the way it's laid out. And by the way, that's one of the reasons why the periodic table is so useful. When you lay it out this way, you can figure out what the ions are going to be, at least for some of them, very easily. So let me review really quickly, and then we need to talk about the center part of the table. The guys on the right-hand side in the column 8, they're perfect gases. We call them noble gases. The elements in the columns very near in the nonmetals on the right-hand side, like, you know, nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, chlorine, those things, they want to gain electrons to be like a noble gas, and they gain the number of electrons needed to hop over to be like in column 8. The guys in the first two columns on the left-hand side, in the metal side of the periodic table, they like to lose electrons needed to do the same thing. So the guys in group 1 lose one electron to wrap around to be like a noble gas, and the guys in group 2, they lose 2 electrons. So bottom line, on the left-hand side of the periodic table, since they're losing electrons, those are going to be positive ions. On the right-hand side, those are gaining electrons, or they want to gain electrons, so they're going to try to become negative ions. So that's what's happening in the periodic table. Everybody on the left-hand side of that jagged line wants to be positive, so they do this by losing electrons. Everything on the right-hand side of that line wants to be negative, and they do this by gaining electrons, okay? So we've talked about how to predict what the charges are going to be on the left and on the right-hand side. What about the middle of the periodic table? There's a huge chunk of elements right in the middle of the table. You've got some really common elements here, like iron, copper, silver, gold, tungsten, that's in your light bulbs, chromium, manganese, cobalt, things like that. They're all metals. They're the transition elements in the center of the table. They all like to be positive also. They like to lose electrons as well, but the trick with those guys is that it's not always predictable. And that's really the problem with the middle part of the periodic table. You're not going to be able to count columns in the middle part of the periodic table to figure out what the ions are going to be. But I can tell you that from experience, those guys in the center and the transition elements in general, they are going to want to be plus 2 or plus 3. So they're going to basically want to lose 2 or lose 3 electrons. Some of them like to lose 1 electron also, but there's no hard and fast rule. So in your chemistry book somewhere, when in your chapter on ions and ionic bonding, there should be a table or a diagram or something to help you out and tell you which ones, for instance, want to be plus 2, which ones want to be plus 3, but you cannot figure it out by counting columns when you get to the center of the periodic table. That only works for groups 1 and 2, and it only works on the right-hand side as well. So let's take an example. If we look in the center of the periodic table, and you look at iron is Fe, so we look at this guy here. you can't figure out what its charge wants to be by counting. But I can tell you by your book, really, by experiments, you find a table in your book, that iron wants to form a +2 or a +3 ion. That means that iron is stable if it loses 2 electrons or if it loses 3 electrons, and either one can happen. So that's different from the other guys. The guys on the edges of the table, they pretty much have one stable ion that you can pretty much count on. The guys in the center, there a lot of them have 2 stable ions. So because of that, we name them like that. So we call the Fe +2 ion, we call it the iron 2 ion, where 2 is a Roman numeral 2 in parentheses. The 2 in parentheses tells you that the iron has a positive 2 charge. The other ion, if it loses another electron, so it's +3, is called an iron 3 ion, where the number 3 is Roman numeral in parentheses. Okay, cobalt, CO, behaves the same way. It likes to lose 2 electrons or it likes to lose 3 electrons. So you can go to a chemical supply company and purchase cobalt. Maybe you can purchase something with cobalt 2 ions in it, let's say. So you would see that written as cobalt parentheses 2 there. Or if it was the other ion, +3, you would see cobalt 3 ion. And we use this nomenclature with the parentheses when we're naming our compounds. We'll see that in the next section, but I'm kind of giving you a little bit of a preview. Copper. Copper likes to do a lot of things, but it likes to, in one case, lose 1 electron to become copper +1, and also copper +2. So it'll lose 1 electron or it'll lose 2 electrons. So we call it the same way, copper 1 or copper 2. But not all of the guys in the center like to form multiple ions. Silver is mostly stable when it just loses 1 ion. So we just know that's the only real stable ion there. Lead, Pb. Is mostly stable when it loses 2 electrons, so it's Pb +2. There's no hard and fast way for you to memorize this, to memorize which of these guys in the center of the table like to lose 2 electrons, which of them like to lose 3 electrons, which of them like to lose both. There's really no way for you to memorize it. So when we get to that point, you really need to look in your book and figure out where it's giving you the full list. And also, to be honest with you, you'll pick up a lot of it as we just work through problems, because you'll figure out, for instance, that iron, there's always later on when we get to naming compounds, you'll always see that there's an iron 2 oxide if it combines with oxygen, and there's also an iron 3 oxide when it combines with oxygen. Going back to cobalt, you'll learn over time that cobalt likes to be cobalt 2 oxide if it combines with oxygen, or cobalt 3 oxide. The 3 and the 2 tell you which ion you've dealt with to form that compound, basically. So on the edges of the table, the left-hand side, the right-hand side, you can predict with certainty what charge you're going to have. So you can predict with certainty what compound you're going to have, and there's no ambiguity. But in the center of the table, a lot of these transition metals have 2 or more different ions that they like to form. So if that's the case, and the only way you're going to know is if you have a table in your book, if that's the case, then when you name a compound, or if you just name the ion, you have to put the charge in parentheses, basically. So iron 2 ion, or iron 3 ion, or cobalt 2 ion, or cobalt 3 ion, or so on and so forth. And that's basically how it works. So it's very important for you to know that's how the periodic table is laid out. Make sure and watch this section a couple times. Make sure you truly understand how it's all set up, because when we get into naming ionic compounds and writing down formulas for ionic compounds, which we're going to do in the very next section, it's imperative that you understand that, because knowing the charges on the ion is the method that we use to write the formulas down. So it's very, very important. I'm Jason with MathTutorDVD.com. I hope you've gotten something from this. Definitely go over it a few times. Make sure you understand it. And knowing how the periodic table is laid out and organized can really give you the leg up on your test and on your exams.
Learn anything at MathAndScience.com.